completely taken aback by what I was seeing.
Why are you sneezing on me?
We're not sweet.
Oh, you are!
Stop fighting.
I'm not trapped like this.
Stop fighting.
I didn't know that children in Australia were allowed to be put in isolation.
So can you paint a picture of an isolation cell for me?
An isolation cell is basically this tiny windowless room. There's nothing inside it, not even a toilet, no mattresses, no water. Sometimes it's called a padded cell, which makes it sound really cushiony and comfortable, but it's actually made of hardened rubber.
Oh.
So yes, it's not particularly comfortable.
Why would people end up in this isolation cell then?
Well, people who end up in isolation are usually self-harming or, you know, maybe they're violent and they need to be separated from other people. These cells are usually found in prisons or in custody kind of environments. So they're basically used for people who are somehow a danger to themselves or to others, so they need to be separated. But there are some youth workers and some lawyers who say that these cells are also being used for punishment.
Are these isolation cells made for adults?
Yes, mainly, but we know that there are also children who are being held inside these isolation cells, particularly in Queensland. I know one girl who was put there after throwing toilet paper at a police camera. She was 13 at the time.
So you spent months talking to people who have spent time in isolation cells in Queensland. What is it like in there?
From what I've heard, it's really, you know, there's not much stimulation in there. You're basically just staring at a blank wall because there's nothing else for you to do. So people say time goes really slowly in there. You know, 10 minutes could feel like an hour or even 2 hours. I've also heard it's really hard to sleep because the cells can be freezing cold because under the rubber walls there is a layer of concrete. That's what the cells are made of.
What kind of stories did you hear from people who had ended up in watch houses?
So one of the young people that I spoke to said, you know, it's a horrible kind of place for a person to be. You know, you don't know when you're getting out. You know, it's often overcrowded. You might be sharing a cell with 4 or 5 other kids. You know, sometimes you go hungry. You're not fed your lunch until dinner time.
I saw you actually got this footage of this girl in isolation.
Oh, this lady said she was going to talk to me. She said you want to talk to me, like.
So it's been like 7 times today. You're under a cell like 6 times.
It's not a kid in there.
How did you manage to get that?
So this was part of an investigation we did with Guardian Australia. So their reporter, Ben Smee, was actually the one who got a hold of the footage. Mm-hmm. So he's been investigating this topic for years. He's been, you know, working on stories about youth crime. He's been talking to all the families of the young people who end up in the system. And so basically he was given this, you know, never before seen police footage of, you know, it's children in isolation cells in Queensland police watch houses, which are police facilities meant for adults in Queensland, but they're also used to hold children. And it's actually the first time that we've actually seen what happens to children inside these isolation cells.
So we've been talking about watch houses and isolation cells. Like, what is the distinction?
So the watch house is the general building where children are held, mm-hmm. That are attached to police stations. Mm-hmm. And within the watch houses, there are a few smaller cells which are isolation cells, mm-hmm. specifically designed for people who are being a danger to themselves or others. Yep. And they're different from the general cells where you would typically go.
It is too cold in here.
That vision was incredibly confronting to watch that girl in distress and to struggle with police officers and police officers also trying to contain her and keep her safe as well. And the sound of her distress was like very confronting. Does that still stick with you?
Yeah, for sure. I remember watching that footage for the first time and just being, you know, completely taken aback by what I was seeing, you know, and the fact that it was happening in Australia as well. Like, I didn't know that children in Australia were allowed to be put in isolation. What really sticks with me is that she's screaming, she's struggling with the officers who are trying to put her inside the cell. She tries to get out of the cell multiple times. And there's this moment towards the end of the video where Basically, she gets her hand shut in the door by the officers as she's trying to escape and they're trying to keep her in.
On the fourth attempt, the door is shut on her arm.
And I remember, like, the scream she made and just that vision was quite awful and still makes me cringe when I watch it to this day.
Yeah. Every time that, like, slam of the door and that reaction is, like, very visceral, almost like blood chilling.
So the officers actually initially thought they had broken her hand, so they took her to the hospital for treatment. And we do have body cam footage afterwards of her being taken out of the hospital at 2 a.m. and being taken back to the watch house.
It was also really confronting to learn that this girl was living with a disability and had the mental capacity of a five-year-old. Are there a lot of kids with disability who end up in the system?
Yeah, so they're actually overrepresented in the system in Queensland. So this girl has Fetal Alcohol Spectrum Disorder, or FASD for short, which is a condition caused by exposure to alcohol in the womb.
Why are you putting your finger in my throat?
Listen, you are not listening to instructions, okay?
Yeah, I never spat on anyone, did I? No, I didn't.
Get your hands off me.
I didn't spit on anyone!
So people with FASD generally tend to have a reduced ability to regulate themselves, you know, their executive function, which is the part of the brain that controls decision making and consequences and things like that, is impaired. So Sam, for example, she doesn't really understand why she's been arrested a lot of the time. You know, she'll ask to go home once she's been put in the watch house. And yeah, her capacity for understanding the consequences of her actions is quite limited.
Does the justice system take FASD into account when working with people who have FASD?
They do to some extent, but it is a very underdiagnosed condition. Right. So a lot of the kids who end up in the system who have FASD might not even realise they have it, which makes it really difficult to know how to handle them.
Why is FASD underdiagnosed?
There's a whole bunch of reasons, but one of them is that FASD is quite complicated to diagnose, actually. You need a number of different experts, not just one, to make a diagnosis, which is why, you know, a lot of children slip through the cracks.
This was such a massive project. What did you learn from doing the doc?
So when I started this doco, I didn't even know that children could be held in adult police facilities in Queensland. Watch houses are attached to police stations and they're usually designed for adults who are acting drunk or disorderly, or if they've just been arrested and are waiting to be processed. But last year, Queensland retrospectively changed the Human Rights Act to allow children to be held in watch houses.
So if kids are ending up in watch houses, how long is it before they get out?
Well, there have been reports of kids who have been in there for weeks. There are psychologists who have seen children going to the watch houses and seen their mental health declining in the first 24 hours that they're there. Mm-hmm. So you can imagine what would happen if a child spent weeks inside a watch house.
Is there any proof that putting kids or holding kids in watch houses actually works and prevents them from reoffending?
A lot of the evidence actually points to the fact that it's doing the opposite. So that watch houses are not preventing children from reoffending. So in Queensland, most kids who do end up behind bars do reoffend. We know that for a fact.
So has anything changed since the investigation came out?
Yeah, so recently the Queensland Police actually came out and said they'll be doing a review of watch houses. So basically the commissioner came out and admitted that there were systemic issues in the watch houses, and that so far this year police have received over 100 allegations already about things that have happened inside the watch house. There's also been different human rights groups, you know, youth advocates, people like that who have, you know, who have basically said, you know, what we're doing is wrong and children shouldn't be in the watch house.
So if kids end up in a watch house, does that mean they are guilty of a crime?
Not necessarily. So children in watch houses are actually on remand, which means they've been placed there because they've been arrested by police and they're waiting to see a court. So they might have been charged with a crime, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they'll be convicted of one, which is one of the things that struck me as well, the fact that they could spend weeks in a watch house and, you know, end up not even being guilty of anything.
Why are Queensland's youth detention centres overflowing?
Queensland has been really focusing on youth crime lately. They like to say that they have a really tough stance on crime, which is why a lot of children are ending up in detention centres as well. The opposition has said that if it's elected, it'll bring in a policy called adult crime, adult time. Mm. So basically what they're saying is that children who commit serious crimes should be given the same sentences as adult criminals. And it's important to remember that in Queensland, children as young as 10 years old can be found guilty of a crime. So that's quite a bold kind of policy. And the current Youth Justice Minister, actually, Di Farmer, who we spoke to, back in 2019, she was saying things like, you know, we shouldn't have a lock them up and throw away the key approach, which is really interesting because now Queensland is building new youth detention centres because there are just too few spaces to keep up with the amount of kids that are going into the system.